Jesus Christ. What can I give him? you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, you made this holy night shine with the brightness of the true light. Grant that here on earth we may walk in the light of Jesus' presence, and in the last day wake to the brightness of his glory. Through your only Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Lesson from Isaiah. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who lived in a land of deep darkness, on them light has shined. You have multiplied the nation, you have increased its joy. They rejoice before you as with joy at the harvest, as people exult with dividing thunder. For the yoke of their burden and the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor, you have broken as on the day of Midian. For all the boots of the tramping warriors and all the garments rolled in blood shall be burnt as fuel for the fire. For a child has been born for us, a son given to us. Authority rests upon his shoulders, and he is named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. His authority shall grow continually, and there shall be endless peace for the throne of David and his kingdom. He will establish and uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time forward and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
To the Lord, you families of all peoples, ascribe to the Lord.
training us to renounce impiety and worldly passions, and in the present age to live lives that are self-controlled, upright, and godly, while we wait for the blessed hope and the manifestation of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. He it is who gave himself for us that he might redeem us for all our iniquity and purify for himself a people of his own who are zealous for good deeds. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Syria. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to the city of David called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and family of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged and who was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for her to deliver her child. And she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in bands of cloth and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the inn. In that region, there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. For see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace among those whom he favors." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go now to Bethlehem and see this thing that has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us." So they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the child lying in the manger. When they saw this, they made known what had been told them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds told them. But Mary treasured all these words and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen, as it had been told them. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Thank you.
Christ. Amen. When it comes to Christmas, most of, if not all of us, have been part of long-standing traditions. One of them, of course, are gatherings with family or maybe close friends, especially for a holiday dinner. Get-togethers, ranging from just a handful to maybe a good number of people. The same household may always host it, and often the same main entree is served, along with the same side dishes and desserts as well. Yet over time, traditions do change, often gradually, sometimes suddenly. For example, when the matriarch in a family becomes chronically ill, or perhaps even dies. Or maybe it happens when a difference of opinion among two or more persons turns into a disagreement, which turns into a fight, which turns into a cutoff, a complete estrangement. Please indulge me now for a few minutes as I share with you some Christmas gatherings I've experienced over the years, and they may remind you of some of your own, at least in part. From my childhood and teenage years, I vividly remember the get-togethers on my mother's side of the family. We all lived within 25 miles of one another, up in northern Ohio. Grandparents, aunts, uncles, and cousins, total 20 people or so. Grown-ups would sit at the dining table, while two or three card tables and folding chairs were set up for the rest of us. All the dishes were homemade. The standard, things like green bean casseroles, mashed potatoes, turkey stuffing and gravy, and among my favorites for desserts, fruit pies, the crusts of which were always made from scratch. After the meal, we would hold a gift exchange, the names having been drawn from the previous month at Thanksgiving. Here's one thing I remember about it. No one ever knew what else to get for teenage boys except men's cologne. So over a period of several years, my older brothers amassed a collection that they arranged in a long line on a table in one of the bedrooms. Old Spice, Brute, Stetson, and so conspicuous with its large wooden top, English leather. To my recollection, neither of my brothers ever opened up any of them. When some cousins started getting married, our houses were no longer big enough, so we began renting the fellowship hall at a nearby church. In recent years, now that all the aunts and uncles are gone, and the rest of us have our own families, many including grandchildren, we now get together just in the summer for a potluck at a city park. Other Christmases, after my spouse Deborah and I were married and lived first in Florida and then in Tennessee, we spent a couple of them on our own, but most of the time made it back to her side of the family in Texas. Not quite as many people as I had grown up with, but very, very festive and still wonderfully made holiday food. Not all Christmases are the same, are they? One year in the mid-90s, it was a day or two after we celebrated at my parents'. The doctor called to tell my mother that my father's cancer had returned, that he had about 6 months and he lasted 4.5. 5 years later, in November, my mother died from a stroke. Those two Christmases were not very good. And now, for the first time in 25 years, my immediate family and I are spending it apart. There's Deborah with her father, who has Alzheimer's, and with our son and my sister-in-law and my niece. For Deborah, it's the first Christmas without her mother. Meanwhile, our daughter is staying in Chicago, where she has lived for the past 2 years. And as you can see, here I am in York. My family wanted me to stay put. They're all concerned about me, given how contagious and potentially dangerous COVID-19 is, now that I am in an older person risk category. They want to be sure I stay healthy, that nothing bad happens to me. My daughter especially seems that way. I've been telling others that's because her smartphone is still on our family plan, which she doesn't think is very funny at all. At the same time, I won't really be having Christmas dinner by myself. At home, I have two four-legged children who are always happy to see me, and the three of us will be sharing the holiday meal. This year, most of us are in the same boat, aren't we? That's true no matter whether family members or friends are nearby or far away. So thank goodness, not only for telephones, but also Skype, Zoom, and FaceTime. There are any number of people who often spend Christmas alone, or at least not with loved ones. I think of those serving in our armed forces. I think of some persons in our congregation, especially those who are homebound. I think about people who have no home at all to live in. And I think of patients in hospitals and residents at nursing homes and their families who this Christmas won't get to see one another at all. And at many homes this year, there will be an empty chair at the table. This December 25th, 2020 seems to be a Christmas like no other, and yet in a vastly different way, we can say the same thing about the very first Christmas. Mary and Joseph alone, and then with the baby Jesus. The only visitors, shepherds, are strangers to them, and they stay but a short time. Still, Mary and Joseph and the baby are not alone. God is watching over them. In fact, through the Christ child, God is with them, God incarnate. No matter what our circumstances, Jesus blesses us with his presence. He is here in this place of worship. He is with each and every one of you taking part in this service via Facebook, or YouTube, or on our church website. Whether you are with at least one loved one, or several, or maybe with a friend or two, even if you're alone, you're not truly alone. Jesus is with you. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, the Messiah, the Lord. Amen.
Thank you.
I invite you to stand as we confess our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one name with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
Joining our voices with the songs of the angels, let us pray for the church, the world, and all who are in need. The shepherds sing, Jesus Christ is born. Let your church throughout the world proclaim this good news over the hills and everywhere. Unite the voices of all your faithful people in songs of praise and rejoicing. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Heaven and nature sing joy to the world. Give respite to flocks, fields, and those who tend them. Come near to us in the beauty of nighttime, the shining of the stars, in the hush of a world at rest. May our wonder at your creation rouse our care for all the earth. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
The angels sing peace on earth. Come quickly to still the strife of this world. Hush the noise of war and violence in places of unrest. Inspire leaders of nations to seek lasting peace and sustainable provisions for all in their care. Hear us, O God.
Mercy is great.
Mary sings melodies of comfort to her newborn child. Bring rest and reassurance to those facing struggles this night. Shelter travelers and those without homes. Console those who lie awake due to pain or anxiety. Heal those who are sick or hurting, especially Dave Blamire, Tom Gross, Steve Heilman, and Phyllis Richards, relative of Rochelle Nyman, and Bud Walker, cousin of Mary Shelley. Hear us, O God.
Mercy is great.
Love sings through the sound of a new baby's cry. Bless new parents and expectant parents. Comfort those who long for children. Surround families of all kinds with your love and care. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
The heavenly chorus sings, glory to God in the highest. We give you thanks for all the saints who have proclaimed your glory in word and deed. Let us join them this night in joyful praise around your eternal throne. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of mercy, come quickly to us with grace upon grace as we lift these and all our prayers to you. In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Please be seated.
As the child is there to be, to guide us on the way.
Let us pray. Loving Father, we rejoice in the birth of Jesus, who came among the poor to bring the riches of your grace. As you have blessed us with your gifts, let them be blessing for others. With the trees of the field, with all earth and heaven, we shout for joy in the coming of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is indeed right and salutary that we should at all times and in all places offer thanks and praise to you, O Lord, Holy Father, through Christ our Lord. In the wonder and mystery of the Word made flesh, you have opened the eyes of faith to a new and radiant vision of your glory, that beholding the God made visible, we may be drawn to love the God whom we cannot see. And so with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. You so loved the world that you gave your only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but have eternal life. We give you thanks for his coming into the world to fulfill for us your holy will and to accomplish all things for our salvation. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." For as often as we eat of this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Remembering, therefore, his salutary command, his life-giving passion and death, his glorious resurrection and ascension, and the promise of his coming again, we give thanks to you, O Lord God Almighty, not as we ought, but as we are able. We ask you mercifully to accept our praise and thanksgiving, and with your word and Holy Spirit to bless us, your servants, and these your own gifts of bread and wine, so that we and all who share in the body and blood of Christ may be filled with heavenly blessing and grace, and receiving the forgiveness of sin, may be formed to live as your holy people and be given our inheritance with all your saints. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ is the true bread that has come down from heaven. He is our Emmanuel, God with us. Come to the banquet, for now all is ready.
Lord, feed us with your love.
We give you thanks, gracious God, that you have once again fed us from your very self with the body and blood of Christ. Through this mercy, send us forth to proclaim your promise to to a world in need through the same Jesus Christ, our Savior.
The Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.